Dr. Lawrence, the Cleveland, and thank you, Dr. Ravano, for such an interesting paper. I got a lot of lessons from there. So I do macroeconomics, and for the most part, it's real macroeconomics. So I find that financial economics is an altogether different animal. Okay, so here's my comments. Here are my comments on the paper. Okay, the paper essentially defines financial market resilience as the ability of the financial system. Can I please have the first slide? Okay, so let me read again. Financial market resilience is the ability of the financial system to withstand systemic shocks such as the financial meltdown that marked the onset of the global financial crisis in 2007. Now, such resilience implies... How do we work this? Such resilience implies an effective management of what we call systemic risks or system-wide risks. In turn, effective risk management implies a recognition that not all risks are equally bad. In fact, potentially destabilizing innovations and opportunities that can potentially catapult the economy to a higher trajectory might be even necessary in order to generate long-run growth. Okay, so the picture is that leg of a bamboo, just like in our programs. Okay, what's with the bamboo? Okay, the bamboo doesn't avoid typhoons or the shocks. Okay, but when it's buffeted by the shocks, it's resilient enough that it sways with the shocks, so that after the typhoon has passed, it's still standing strong and tall. Now, the main pieces of the paper can be structured in terms of the key lessons to be learned from the global financial crisis experience. So bear with me as I go through some of these. Okay, so the first lesson is that it is not sufficient to ensure the soundness of financial soundness of individual financial institutions to ensure the soundness of the entire financial system, as the complexities arising from myriad financial interactions generate risk of a systemic nature, which is more than the sum of the individual parts, as Dr. Ravano said. Add to this the complexities arising from international financial connections. Okay, so thus microprudential regulation, which was the buzzword before the onset of the global financial crisis, the main theme of Basel I and Basel II, is not sufficient to prevent the buildup of excessive systemic risk. Now, the second lesson is that systemic risk has both cross-sectional and temporal dimensions that policymakers have to pay attention to. The cross-sectional dimension relates to how risks are distributed among individual financial institutions and how different financial institutions are interconnected and the implications of these on the soundness of the system as a whole. Now, the new part there, which the global financial crisis has uncovered, is the temporal dimension, okay, which focuses on the accumulation of risks over the business or financial cycle. This is in line with the observation that the buildup of systemic risk is pro-cyclical and endogenous. During good times, during booms, there is a tendency for agents to undervalue risk, which tends to incentivize excessive risk-taking behavior. The third lesson is that to effectively manage systemic risk, macroprudential regulation is required. Now, while the phrase macroprudential regulation is not new, it only became a buzzword among policy circles in the wake of the global financial crisis. Macroprudential regulation takes into account both the cross-sectional and temporal dimensions of systemic risk. In recognition of this need, Basel III is essentially about raising capital requirement ratios that deals with the cross-sectional part, and also adding discretionary countercyclical capital buffers to account for the pro-cyclicality of systemic risk. This is what Borio 2012 calls a lean against a build-up of financial vulnerabilities. And this further implies a more active role, discretionary role for monetary policy. As the former Fed Chair William McChesney Martin said, the Federal Reserve's job, in this case the BSP's, is to take away the punch bowl just as the party gets going. Okay, so as further lesson, macroprudential regulation entails the monitoring and assessment and mitigation of the systemic risk. And for that to be done effectively, it has to be forward-looking, thus requires continuous updating of the relevant information, transparent communication to enable early warning systems. And what Dr. Ravelo earlier mentioned, the operation lies that we have the Financial Stability Committee that oversees the management of systemic risks. Okay, it says that my time's off, but I'm only halfway done, and actually the bulk of my comments are on the first paper. Thank you. Okay, so as a response to the banking crisis, the Banco Central ng Pilipinas has essentially implemented aspects of macroprudential regulation since the 1990s, more on the cross-sectional part. And these efforts afforded the Philippine financial system a degree of resilience in the face of the Asian financial crisis of 1997 and the global financial crisis in 2007. Macroprudential regulation was implemented using bank lending limits to real estate, liquid asset covers, foreign currency deposit buffers. Now, in the wake of the dot-com bubble crash, the general banking law was enacted in late 2000, enhancing the supervisory capacity of the BSP under the auspices of the risk-based capital adequacy framework in Basel I and II. This, according to Enrico Amat, and I quote, sent strong signals to financial institutions to upgrade their risk management systems, build up their capital bases, and reduce their exposures, particularly to non-performing accounts and complex products. Okay, so indeed, the Philippine financial system was reported to fare relatively better in the two most recent crises than that of its neighbors. Now, while this might be in part due to the vigilance of the BSP and the buffers shored up by the financial system, it might also be the case that the Philippine financial system has not had enough exposure to risks relative to its neighbors. For instance, in Aguro 1999, okay, he shows there that while the Philippines exhibited some symptoms of the Asian flu, his conclusion was that it was not exposed enough to incur the damages to the financial structures of our neighbors like Thailand and Singapore. Now, even in the midst of regional upsurge in inflows of portfolio investments, I have here, I don't know if you can see it clearly, okay, but the black line there, okay, these are net portfolio investments in the Philippines. The black line there is the Philippines, okay, the rest are seven other Asian countries. Okay, these are small compared to the rest of our neighbors, more so when it comes to net foreign direct investments. Okay, there is also the issue. The last point is that there is also the issue of a lack of financial development scale. Okay, so this table shows the different measures of financial development often used in the literature. You have domestic credit there, private credit, bank credit, broad money, okay, stocks traded. Now, if you compare across income groups, the Philippines is just right above the average of low-income countries. Okay, and it's way below the average scale of middle-income countries. Now, Dr. Gachaba, Lisa, and I have some preliminary results regressing using panel data regressions, dynamic panel data regressions, okay, showing the link between manufacturing growth and financial development. And what we find consistently, okay, at least across the first four financial development indicators, is that the total marginal effects are negative, and it's due to a lack of scale economies. Okay, thank you very much.